This conference will now be recorded.
The organizers were given the opportunity to talk on this topic in the holy month of Ramadan. I take the blessings of Krishna, Guru, and all the devotees, all the Vaishnavas, before I start. It is very much needed because without the blessings of Guru, Krishna, and Vaishnavas, it's difficult. And due to any reason, I mean, my pronunciation in shlokas or any information is not complete or it's wrong or deviated, please forgive me. Consider me as a kindergarten kid. When a KG child goes to school, the first time he or she is told to draw a line, he or she is not able to draw the straight line. It is a bit deviated. So they say it's okay. As the child grows up, when the motor skill gets strengthened, the child will become more expertise. So in the same way, please consider me as a kindergarten child and forgive me if there is anything wrong that I say or. Just a minute, Prabhu. I'll take a second to just adjust this. Yeah, Prabhu, can you see my screen, Prabhu?
Yes, Mataji.
Yes. Yes, Mataji, we are able to see.
Okay, Prabhu, just a minute. Prabhu, I will just adjusting this screen properly. Hare Krishna to all. Sorry for the disturbance. We are just setting up the screen. Today, by the grace of Krishna, Guru, and devotees, I've got this topic of the Mohini Murti incarnation in this holy month of Ramadan. ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय the Mohini Murti incarnation bewilders Lord Shiva. This is Canto 8, Chapter 12. I would like to start with a quote from Srila Prabhupada. Shiva is dahi. I quote, Shiva is dahi and Krishna is milk. Dahi, the preparation of dahi, that you make milk, pure milk, and mix it with little sour thing, then it becomes dahi. Similarly, Krishna is pure spirit, and when this pure spirit is mixed with Maya, that is Shiva. I unquote. Now, we all know that yesterday Sumangala Prabhu did speak about Mohini Murti incarnation. Now we all know that why Lord took Mohini Murthy. In Bhagavatam, there are two places where this pastime comes. One is during the churning of the ocean, and second is when Lord Shiva wants to see the attractive form of the Lord. So these are the two places where Mohini Murthy incarnation happens. Now, if you see the chapter overview, just a summary, I'll say that when this form is happening, when Lord has, when the churning of the ocean has happened, and the nectar of jug has been snatched away by the demigods from Dhanvantri, that's when Lord comes in, takes the form of Mohini Murthy, and to benefit the demigods, he cheats the daityas, and he takes away from the daityas and benefit and gives the nectar to the demigods so that they become immortal. Now here during this churning of the ocean, Shiva's portion is only that much that he takes the poison in his mouth. So Shiva comes to know about this form that the Lord had assumed, had taken the form of Mohini Murthy to help the demigods. So when Shiva listens, hears about this, along with his wife, he mounts on his bull, along with his wife and his associates, the Bhutganas, he reaches the abode of the Lord. Now, he is known as Bhutanath because his associates are the Bhutganas or the ghosts. Now, when he reaches there, as he reaches to the abode of Madhusudana, he glorifies the Lord and desires to see the form. Now, Lord is very kind, very merciful. He is Bhaktavatsala. Krishna always desires to satisfy his pure devotees. Krishna's only desire is to fulfill the desire of the devotees. And then we will see that how Lord Shiva gets influenced. Lord Shiva is a very strong personality. He will not get enchanted with any normal, ordinary woman, or he's not an ordinary person to get enchanted with Lord's external Maya. So we'll see that how he gets influenced by Maya, and in a short time he gets restrained. He restrains himself. He gets back to his form, which Prabhupada clearly says that this is not possible for a normal human being. This happens with Shiva only with the grace of the Lord. So in an ordinary living entity, this is not possible. If we don't take the shelter of the Lord, or if we are not in Bhakti Yoga, not in the process of Bhakti Yoga. So we will see in the rest of the slides that how it happens. Now, we know that Bhagavatam is being narrated by Sukadeva Goswami to Parikshit Maharaj. We know that in what circumstances it's happening. The Parikshit Maharaj is listening this ripened fruit from the lotus feet, from the lotus mouth of Sukadeva Goswami. So Sukadeva Goswami is telling to Parikshit Maharaj that when Shiva heard about this form, he was very much, because Shiva is a devotee, he's a Param Vaishnava, he's a pure devotee of the Lord. So a devotee wishes to see the Lord in a different form. So it was very simple for Shiva also to desire that he wanted to see Lord in the beautiful woman form. So he, along with his wife Uma and his associates, he approaches Lord Hari. When he reaches the abode of Hari, Supreme Personality of Godhead receives them with great respect. Now, here we see that Lord Shiva is not doing any wrong. His intentions are very clear, to just see the form of the Lord, and he's accompanied by his wife. When a person is accompanied by his wife, we can assume that he will not do anything wrong. So here Lord has a clear intention. Lord Shiva has got a clear intention that he wants to see the form of the Lord, and he reaches the abode of Lord Vishnu. Now, in the next few shlokas from 4 to 11, we'll see that how Lord Mahadev is glorifying Lord Vishnu, because Mahadev knows the position of Lord Vishnu. And Prabhupada also says that glorification is must. It's a spiritual etiquette. Why we need it? Because even when we are approaching the Lord to ask for something, before that we offer our prayers to Lord and then we ask. Even if we are meeting a senior devotee, we pay our obeisances to them, we glorify them, and then we start talking to them. Even when we are going to meet our Guru Maharaj, or we see our Guru Maharaj, we chant the Guru Pranam Mantra, and then we start inquiring about the Guru, or start talking with the Guru. So that's how it is. So the same way Lord Mahadev knows his position, and that's the reason he is glorifying the Lord before he puts his desire in front of Lord Krishna. Now he says that you are the Deva Deva, all pervading Jagat Vyapi, master of the universe. You are transformed by your energy into this creation. You are Jaganmay, root and cause of everything, not material. Super soul or supreme living force of everything. You are the Parmeshwar, the supreme controller of everything. Now, if we see that the three chief demigods are Vishnu, Brahma, and Shiva. Vishnu exists as the Sattvagun Avatara in this material world, Lord Shiva as the Tamogun Avatara, and Brahma as the Rajogun Avatara. Though they fall, they are in this category, but Vishnu is above them. He is totally separate from, he is not in the same category. So Lord Vishnu is Deva Deva, the chief of all demigods. Now, Lord Shiva is in this material world as a energy of Lord Vishnu. He knows this. So that's the reason he's saying that you are all pervading, the Jagat Vyapi. Sometimes Lord Shiva is also known as the Maheshwara. So when some people, they refer him as Maheshwara, and so people tend to think that Lord Shiva is everything. But Lord Shiva, he is himself saying to Lord Vishnu, he's himself addressing to Lord Vishnu as the master of universe, the Jagadisha. So he's the master of Lord Shiva also. And he's Shiva is also sometimes called as Vishveshwara. Vishveshwara means the master of the universe. And so the meaning of Jaganmay here is that you are transformed by energy into this creation. So when Lord Shiva, he knows that he is the part and he is the another principal expansion of Lord Vishnu. So that's why he says that you are even my Lord. You are even my master. I am under your control. So Lord Vishnu is the master of the spiritual world as well as the master of the material world. So we can understand this by the Bhagavad Gita Shloka 9.10, Maya Dakshena Prakriti Suyate Sacharacharam. That is, under my direction, the creation happens, and you can see all the moving and unmoving thing that works, everything under my direction. He says that you are the root cause of everything. So Brahma Samhita says, Ishvara Parama Krishna Satchidananda Vigra Anadi Radir Govinda Sarva Karana Karanam. Then he says, Super Soul or Supreme, living force of everything. Brahma Samhita 5.35 says, Andantarastha Parmanu Chayantarastham. That is, even the smallest, the minute of Parmanu, we can see, we can feel the presence of Vishnu in it. So in this world, everything is created by Lord, and everything works under the direction, perfectly under the direction of the Lord. So that's the reason sometimes Brahma and Shiva are also called as Ishvara, but Lord Vishnu is the Parameshwara, Parameshwara. It is said in Brahma Samhita, Ishvara Parama Krishna. So Lord Shiva is saying that you are Parameshwara, the supreme controller of all controllers. He further says that you are the manifest and the unmanifest, false ego, beginning, maintenance, and annihilation, all comes from you. Changes as birth, death, and sustenance do not exist in you. Why? Because you are the absolute truth, supreme absolute spirit soul, and supreme Brahman. Now, if we see this in the purport, Prabhupada has quoted the shloka of Bhagavad Gita 7.4, which says that earth, water, fire, air, ether, mind, intelligence, and false ego all together, this eight comprises my separated material energies. So Prabhupada is saying here that everything, whatever we see in the cosmic manifestation, the ingredients are coming from the Lord. So if the ingredients are coming from the Lord, that doesn't mean that Lord has become incomplete. Prabhupada says, no, he's complete. The Lord is full. Purnasya Purnam Adaya Purnam Eva Vashishyate. Because he is complete, whole, even though so many complete units emanates from him. And we also have to understand the philosophy of simultaneously one and different. Achintya Bheda Abheda. That is, quantitatively we are one, but qualitatively we are different. So the Lord here is So when we understand this philosophy of simultaneously one and different, we can understand the absolute truth very clearly. Prabhupada says that he is avyaya, that is inexhaustible and changes. Because he is avyaya, he is the absolute truth, the full spiritual supreme Brahman. Lord Mahadev further says that the saintly and the pure devotees who desire to achieve the highest goal in life and who are completely free from all material desires for sense gratification and engage constantly in the transcendental service of your lotus feet. So when we get into the platform of or the symptom of material life, when we start identifying ourselves with the body and we give reference to my, we speak or we do things with reference to my body. So in Srimad Bhagavatam 5.5.8 says, this is my house. When we get into this material conception of this is my house, my land, my father, this is my state, that's when we get completely entangled. In the shloka, there is a word used as muniyaha, that is the munis. So Prabhupada is giving us an example of Narad Muni, who is always in the service, transcendently in the service of the Lord. He is not bothered about anything. He doesn't desire anything for the self sense gratification. He is always in the service of the lotus feet of the Lord. So those who are always in the service of the lotus feet of the, they are not concerned with dharma, artha or karma. They are concerned with the moksha. Moksha, which kind, which Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has given us, that we should be serving the lotus feet of the Lord, not the one which Mayavadi says that we should become one with the Lord. So when such devotees are freed from the dualities of the material desires, they are called as Shreya Kamaha. And the devotees like Narad Muni and saintly person, they are always in the pure devotional service without aspiration and without desiring for material profit, neither in this life nor in the next life. And they are only interested in serving the lotus feet of the Lord. Further, he says that you are the supreme Brahman, complete in everything, completely spiritual, eternally free from the modes of material nature, transcendental bliss, no lamentation, causes of all causes, nothing can exist without you, different but one, original cause of creation, maintenance and annihilation, bestow benediction, dependent and independent, dependent, independent, cause and effect. The example is given of the gold ornament and the gold from the mine. Brahman is true and world false, not possible. So here we can understand that by the two shlokas that has been, that the shloka in Bhagavad Gita which says 9.4 says, Maya tatam idam sarvam jagat avyakta murtina matstani sarva bhutani na chaham desh avastita. By me, in my unmanifested form, this entire universe is pervaded. All beings are in me, but I'm not in them. So again, the philosophy of simultaneously one and different comes in. Now, further going down, further moving, we say that he's saying that Lord is transcendently blissful, no lamentation. Brahma Samhita says that Ishvara Parama Krishna Satchidananda Vigraha. And everything is dependent on the Lord, because Lord is the cause of everything. If we want anything, the sanction should be there from the Lord. We are dependent on him for our activities, but he is not dependent on us. He is not dependent on our service. If Lord wants, he can give us the mercy, causeless mercy, to liberate us. But when he decides to give us the liberation, he need not depend on anyone else. Now, when he has to give the sanction, Bhagavad Gita 15.15 says, Mata Smriti Jnanam Apohanam Cha. That is, the forgetfulness, knowledge, and remembrance comes from me. When we are dependent completely on him, so this is what here Lord Shiva is saying, that we are dependent on him, but he is independent of us. A pure devotee continuously offers transcendental loving service to the Lord, but if the Lord wants, he can give us mercy. If he wants to give mercy to anyone without depending on our service, we get the causeless mercy of the Lord. But Then once someone gets the mercy of the Lord, they are called as Kripa Siddha. But that stage, we only, that platform we reach when, after many births and deaths. That is Bahunam Janmanam Ante Jnana Avan Mam Prapadyate. Further, he says the cause and the effect. That can be understood by the example of the gold ornament. Now, Lord Shiva says that your lordship alone is the cause and the effect. Therefore, although you appear to be two, you are actually one. So there is no difference when a gold is an unmolded gold in the mine and molded gold turned into an ornament, into a jewelry. Both are the same. There is no difference between the cause and the effect. Both are the same. Only because of ignorance of some people, they concord the differences and the dualities. Lord Shiva further says that you are free from the material contamination, and since the entire cosmic is caused by you and cannot exist without you, it is an effect. This is all an effect of your transcendental service, transcendental qualities. Thus, the conception that the Brahman is true and world is false not possible, because for Vaishnava, the Jagat cannot be Mithya. It is said that Brahma Satyam, Jagat Mithya. Now, for the Vaishnava, this cannot be possible, because they connect everything in connection to the Supreme Personality of the Godhead. In Bhakta Rasamrit Sindhu 1.2.255 to 256, it is said that things should be accepted for the Lord's service and not for one's personal sense gratification. If one accepts something without attachment and thinking that to be the Krishna's property, it is related to Krishna, then that person is in renunciation, called yukta vairagya. So whatever is favorable for rendering to the service of the Lord, we should be accepting it and should not reject as a material thing. So Jagat should not be rejected as Mithya. It is true, and the true is realized when everything is engaged in the service of the Lord. If we give the example of a flower being offered to the Lord, before offering to the, if a person is taking, is plucking the flower and smelling it, then we say it is for his own sense gratification. But when it is offered to the Lord and then it is smelled, then it becomes spiritual. The same way, when the food one cooks is for oneself, then it becomes a material thing. But when it is cooked and offered to the Lord, it becomes a prasadam. So therefore, the Supreme Lord is everything, and he is one without differentiation. There is no existence separate from the Supreme Personality of the Godhead. Further, he glorifies, saying that different people see Lord in a different way. Impersonalists regard you as impersonal Brahman. Mimamsa philosophers regard you as religion. Sankhya philosophers regard you as the transcendental beyond Prakriti and Purusha, controller of demigods. Followers of devotional service, Pancharatras, endow you with nine different potencies. And Patanjali philosophers regard you as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who has no equal or superior. Now Lord Shiva is saying that I who consider myself as the best of, one of the best of the demigods, and Lord Brahma and great rishis like Marichi, who are born in the mode of goodness, cannot understand. We are bewildered by your illusionary energy, and we cannot understand this creation. So what to say about others? There are others like living entities and the demigods, who are the demons, who are in the different modes of material nature. So if we cannot understand it, how others will know you? So he's saying that how others can know you. So it's clearly said in the purport, Prabhupada says that one can understand the Supreme Personality as he is only by the devotion service, by the process of bhakti yoga, by taking the shelter of the lotus feet. In Srimad Bhagavatam, it is said, by rendering devotional service unto the Personality of God in Shri Krishna, one immediately acquires causeless knowledge and detachment from the world. And he also says that when one is serving the lotus feet of the Lord, though it may take years, many births and deaths, after that you come to a stage of perfection, where in Bhagavad Gita 7.19 we can say Bhavanam Janmanam Ante Jnana Avan Mam Prapadyate Vasudevam Sarvam Iti Samatma Sudurlabha. And he further says that you have surrendered to the lotus feet of Vasudev. He can, then only we can understand the absolute truth. He also teaches Arjuna to give up all the varieties of religion and just surrender unto him. One can understand the Supreme Personality as he is only by the devotional service. And Bhagavad Gita 9.7 also says, Maya Asakta Mana Partha. If one practices Bhakti Yoga, taking shelter of Vasudev, Krishna, simply by hearing Vasudev speak about himself, one can understand everything about him. Now in this shloka, there is a word called Samagram. Samagram means that then we'll completely understand the Lord. So when Shiva is asking this question to, he is glorifying the Lord that when we are not able to understand your greatness, then how can others understand you? He further says that the knowledge, you are the knowledge personified, creator, beginning, maintainer, annihilation. This is done by you. Endeavors made by living entities, bondage and liberated. Because when living entities do something, either they get bonded, they are either bonded or they are liberated. You are present everywhere. You are knower of all. You enter the bodies of all moving and unmoving entities. Your Lord is compared to air, as air is moving in the vast sky and also enters the bodies of all moving and unmoving entities, and he is present everywhere. He knows everything. He is the knower of everything. Though he lives in Goloka, he knows nothing is hidden from him. Nothing is unknown to him. So he is simultaneously present everywhere. Now after glorification, glorification has happened. Lord Shiva has glorified the Lord in a very beautiful manner, in a very truthful, using very truthful description. So now Lord is inquiring from Lord Shiva that what is your purpose of coming here? Now Shiva is saying that I have seen various incarnations of yours, which you have exhibited through your transcendental qualities, but I want to see this beautiful form of Mohini Murti. I wish to see this. I wish to see this beautiful form which has enabled demigods to drink the nectar, which the deityas were captivated and which led them to be cheated, and the nectar jug was taken away from them, or they were not capable of it, so the Lord did not provide it to them. So Shiva is requesting the Lord that we want to see your form. So now Sukadev Goswami is saying to Parikshit Maharaj that when Lord Vishnu hears about this request from Lord Shiva, who holds a trident in his hand, Lord Vishnu has a smile on his face. With gravity, he's thinking. The phrase here in the shloka, the phrase used in shloka is Prahasya Bhava Gambhiram. So why there is gravity in Lord's mind is that Supreme Personality, Lord Vishnu, knows that Lord Shiva is not an ordinary person. He cannot be enchanted with any ordinary woman. He is a very strong personality. And Lord Vishnu is known as Yogeshwara. He is the master, supreme lord of all mystic power. So Lord Vishnu is thinking that the illusionary external energy is represented by Durga Devi, who is the wife of Lord Shiva. If she couldn't captivate Lord Shiva, then which is the form with which I can captivate Lord Shiva? So therefore, Lord Vishnu was grave and at the same time he was smiling. And here in this shloka, the word Girisham is used. Girisham is another name of Lord Shiva. He is known as the Lord of Himalayas. Now, Lord exhibits is in this topic. The further thing is that Lord is saying that why Lord assumed the beautiful form from Mohini Murti, that we know that he wanted to captivate the demons and benefit the demigods. So in the interest of the demigods, he does this. But one point that we have to understand here is that When Lord took the Mohini Murti form, the demigods did not get captivated. The demons got captivated. So Srila Prabhupada is saying that people who are having the the demonic qualities, they always get attracted. They have this lusty desire. They always get attracted or bewildered by the beauty of a world. Whereas the Supreme Person, but people who are on the Krishna conscious, in Krishna conscious or on a platform or on a platform of goodness, they don't get bewildered. So Lord was thinking that Shiva is not an ordinary person. So he cannot be bewildered even by the most beautiful woman. Cupid himself tried it to evoke Lord Shiva's lusty desire in presence of Parvati, but Lord Shiva was never agitated. Instead, Cupid was turned into ash by Lord Shiva's by the blaze fire from Lord Shiva's eyes. So Vishnu had to think twice that which feminine form of mind can induce Lord Shiva to be lusty. That's the reason Lord, in the previous slide, I said that Lord was thinking with gravity. Now, Lord says, okay, you want to see my beautiful form. He said, this beautiful form of mine is appreciated. He's saying, oh, best of the demigods. He's addressing Shiva as the best of the demigods. So he's saying that this form of mine is appreciated by those who are lusty. So shall I reveal to you. Saying this, now, Prabhupada is saying that Lord Shiva's desire to see Lord Vishnu in a most attractive and beautiful form of a woman was certainly a joking affair, because Lord Shiva knew that he could not be agitated by any so-called beauty. Now, Lord Shiva was also thinking one thing. He got a bit proud because he is saying that this form captivated the demons, not the demigods. So I am one of the demigods, then how can I be captivated? Can be captivated by the Lord's beautiful form. So here Prabhupada is saying that Lord Shiva becomes a bit proud about it, and Lord Shiva wanted to see the form. So Lord Vishnu says that, okay, you want to see the form, I am going to impersonate into a beautiful form. But if you get lusty, you become agitated, do not blame me seeing the attractive features of the woman. So this was a test for Shiva to see that of whether Lord Shiva could remain unagitated or not. Saying this, Lord Shiva disappears and Lord Vishnu disappears. Lord Shiva, Uma and his associates are there. They are thinking that from where Lord will come, their eyeballs are moving here and there to look that where Lord has gone. So when this is happening from a nearby forest, a beautiful forest where there are beautiful trees, beautiful leaves, reddish pink color leaves, a beautiful woman covered in a sari who is playing with the ball comes in from the forest. Now here we have to understand one thing, that Krishna is setting an example for us that how Maya can trap us. If a strong personality like Shiva could be trapped, then what to say about us? So the Mohini Murti form is entering from the forest, which is very beautiful. She is playing with the ball. She bounces the ball from one hand to another. While she is playing with her ball, her soft feet, which were reddish like coral, moved here and there. She had a beautiful face, broad, beautiful, restless eyes, which moved the way the ball moved. And her beautiful earrings, which gave a shine on her face with a bluish reflection. Her hair scattered, which made her more beautiful. So this is the form of the Lord who has taken the Mohini Murti incarnation. Now she is dressed in a beautiful sari and ornamented with a belt. Now this is a small description that I've taken from Mohini Murti chapter 8, 41-46. This incarnation of woman, Mohini Murti, was most pleasing to the mind. Her complexion resembled in color a newly grown blackish lotus, and every part of her body was beautifully situated. Her ears were equally decorated with earrings. Her cheek were very beautiful. Her nose was raised and her face full of youthful luster. Her large breast made her waist seem very thin, attracted by the aroma of her face and body. Bumblebees hummed around her, and thus her eyes were restless. Her hair was extremely beautiful, was garlanded with mallika flowers. Her attractively constructed neck was decorated with a necklace and other ornaments. Her arms were decorated with bangles. Her body was covered with a clean sari, and her breasts seemed like islands in an ocean of beauty. Her legs were decorated with ankle bells. Because of the beauty of her eyebrows, as she smiled with shyness and glanced over the demons, all the demons were saturated with lusty desires, and every one of them desired to possess her. So this we see how they are getting captivated. Now, the Lord has shown the, exhibited the beautiful form. And Lord Shiva has got captivated. Lord captivates everyone by his internal potency. Now we have to understand one thing, that Lord Shambhu was not a personality who would get captivated by an external potency of the Lord. Lord Vishnu wanted that Shambhu should get captivated. So what Lord Vishnu did was that he exhibited his external potency to act the way his external potency does for the ordinary living entities. So the Lord could captivate anyone, you know, even such a strong personality as Lord Shambhu. So this shows that we are nothing in front of Maya. Maya is so strong. Now in Bhagavad Gita 7.14, the shloka says, Devahi esha gunamai mama maya duratyaya. The Maya is so strong that if we don't surrender or take service to the lotus feet of the Lord, we will be swept away by Maya. Will not know that when we got captivated, for how many years we will get captivated. Lord can captivate anyone. Now, all these things is happening in presence of his wife, Uma. He forgets himself completely, and this everything is happening in presence of his wife Uma and his associates. So in the Prabhupada is saying that the relation, the bondage of this life, this world begins with the man-woman relationship. A beautiful woman can get attracted to a handsome man, and a handsome man can get attracted to a beautiful woman. Such was the affair, such was the thing happening between Lord Shiva and the beautiful girl. The Cupid was working there. So he was being victimized. Lord Shiva was supposed, is Lord Shiva is above all such attraction, but he was victimized by the captivating power of Lord Vishnu. So Rishabhdev explains the nature of lusty attraction in Srimad Bhagavatam 5.5.8. The attraction between male and female is the basic principle of material existence. On the basis of this misconception, which ties together the hearts of the male and the female, one becomes attracted to his body, home, property, children, relatives, and wealth. In this way, one increases life's illusion and thinks in terms of I and mine. So from here, when there is a lusty exchange of lusty desire between the man and the woman, we are victimized, both are victimized, and thus they are bound to this material world in various way. Now, everything this is happening, Lord Shiva is getting maddened in presence of Bhavani. Everybody can see that he is totally agitated. He's totally agitated sexually and by the various symptoms on the Lord Shiva's body, we can see. Everybody is able to see. His associates are able to see. His wife is able to see. And he's like and Lord Shiva's good senses has got agitated. He has become very lusty. Here the example of an elephant is given, a male elephant who gets attracted towards the she elephant. And in the picture, as it's shown, that Lord Shiva catches the beautiful girl by her braid and tries to pull her towards him. For a moment, Lord Shiva is able to embrace Mohini, but in a few seconds, Mohini slips out of his hand, and Mohini takes him through various places. She is moving in between the trees, wherever the ball, she's playing with the ball, and wherever she is moving, we can see that Lord Shiva is also running behind him. So this all is being seen by all his associates. And it's happening in presence of his wife. Now, Lord Shiva is being harassed by a woman. Now, who is this woman? It's not any ordinary woman. It is Lord himself, Lord Vishnu. So, Lord has various potencies. Lord can captivate anybody with any of his potencies. He does it so expertly, so perfectly, that everybody gets captivated. Now, Lord Shiva had maddened like a bull elephant, who is maddened after a female elephant. So finally, when he is agitated, when the lust desire is at the max, the semen gets discharged, and it doesn't go in vain. So here, Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur is saying that wherever the semen fell, in whichever surface of the globe the semen fell, gold and silver mines appeared later. So Srila Vishwanatha Thakur is saying that those who want opulence, that those who want silver and gold, can worship Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva, he himself stays under the bale tree, who is poverty stricken. He doesn't have a house for him, but his devotees are all opulent. So he comments, Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur comments that if you want opulence, you can devote to Lord Shiva. Now, Mohini Murti is taking Lord Shiva everywhere, in between the rivers, lakes, mountains, forests, great sages where they are meditating in between the mountains. She is doing this to show to the sages that, see, your master, whom you consider him to be your master, he has been enchanted, he has gone mad, and he has become lusty. I can do anything. So he's saying that please be very careful. So in Srimad Bhagavatam 9.19.17, it is said that one should not stay in a solitary place with a woman, even if she be his mother, sister, or daughter, for the senses are so uncontrollably powerful that in the presence of a woman, one may become agitated, even if he is very learned and advanced. Now, Prabhupada used to say about the relation of a man and a woman, man is a butter and woman is a fire. So here, Lord Shiva, we see that he is completely harassed by the Lord Vishnu's internal potency. And we understand that this is not done by any ordinary woman. It has been done by Lord Vishnu himself. Now, when the semen is discharged and Lord Shiva regains his position, so Sukadev Goswami is saying that to Parikshit Maharaj that when he regained his position, when he regained his posture, Lord Shiva understood that he was victimized by the illusion created by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And he was able to understand, he was able to restrain and he could understand his position. Now, Prabhupada has clearly said that this is not possible for everybody. Lord Shiva could restrain himself from any further Maya is that because he was a pure devotee of the Lord. He had the mercy of the Lord. Now, for an ordinary living entity, to get such a mercy, it's very difficult. And once we get entangled in the Maya, it's very difficult to come out. We can take the simple example of Ajamil. Ajamil was a person who had seen in the forest. Now, Ajamil knew all the principles of brahmacharyam, grihastha. He was from a good householder. Still, he knew that he is not supposed to see that. This is Maya. He knew this, that he is not supposed to see that. Still, he got entangled. And it took many years for him to come out of it. During his last days, when he was calling Narayana, Narayana, that's when Vishnu Dutas came. So we can understand that Maya is so strong that she will create havoc in our life. She will make us play on her tune. She can do anything. We feel that we are very strong. We can handle the situation. we will be strong in Maya, but it is not possible. It is not possible to overcome Maya without Krishna's mercy, Guru's mercy, without doing the devotional service, without surrendering to the Lord. So here, Lord Shiva has understood his position. He has understood that Lord has unlimited potencies. He can do anything. He can captivate anyone. He can captivate a strong personality like Shiva. So Prabhupada is saying here that if one can remain a brahmachari, he saves himself so much trouble in material existence. Or if one is educated about sex life and trained to protect it, he is saved from the danger of material existence. So when Shiva comes to know that this is Lord's unlimited potency, having reached his understanding, he is not at all surprised by the wonderful way the Lord has acted. In Bhagavad Gita 7.7, it says, Mata Paratram Nanyat, that is, O conqueror of wealth, there is no truth superior to me. That Krishna is the master of everyone. In Chaitanya Charitamrita also, it says, Ekale Ekale Ishwar Krishna Ara Sava Pratya, that he is the master of everyone, master of even Lord Shiva. So what to speak about others? Now Shiva, though he understood this, that he was put into bewilderment by Lord Vishnu, he was not ashamed of it. Instead, he felt exalted that he had such a powerful person. Lord Shiva remained unagitated and unashamed. Because Lord Shiva, when he understood that this is the Maya, this is the illusionary, the potency of the Lord, after he regained his original form, he was unagitated and unashamed, because he knew that Lord is seated in everyone's heart. From him comes remembrance, knowledge, and forgetfulness. So there's nothing to be hidden from the Lord. Lord knew everything, what was there in Shiva's heart and what he wanted. So he never felt unashamed, and he never felt defeated. When he was defeated by Lord Vishnu, he felt proud that he had such an exalted, strong master. And looking at the Lord Shiva's form, that he was not unagitated or unashamed, Lord Madhusudana is very pleased, and he speaks, now Lord Vishnu glorifies Lord Shiva. He addresses Lord Shiva as, O best of the demigods, although you have been amply harassed because of my potency in assuming the form of a woman, you are established in your position. Therefore, may all good fortune be upon you. Because Lord Vishnu knows that Shiva is Param Vaishnava. Vaishnava Nam Yatha Shambhu. He is not an ordinary person. But sometimes when the devotees, they become a little proud, the Supreme Lord sometimes exhibits his supreme power to dissipate the devotees' misunderstanding. So that's the reason he was being harassed by Lord Vishnu. In 6.22, it is said, because Lord Shiva did not get, even after regaining the form, he did not get unagitated or unashamed. So in 6.22, it says that one is never shaken even in the midst of a greatest difficulty. So that is one of the qualities of a devotee, that even if anything bad happens in the worst or the worst condition, the devotee should not get agitated, because the devotee is always having full faith in the Supreme Personality of the Godhead. Now this was shown by Shambhu, because he is one of the topmost devotee of this Lord. So this is only possible when a pure devotee of the Lord, he is a pure devotee of the Lord. Now, looking at, after seeing this, Lord further says that, my dear Shambhu, who within this material world, but you can surpass my illusionary energy. People are generally attached to the sense enjoyment and conquered by my influence. Indeed, for them, it is very difficult to come out. Because here in purport, Prabhupada is saying that Lord Shiva is neither in the Vishnu Tattva nor the Jiva Tattva, because the demigods, Brahma, Vishnu and Mahesh, all but the Vishnu are not under the influence of Maya. The Vishnu Tattvas are not under the influence of Maya, whereas the living entities other than Vishnu, other than Shiva, are swayed by Maya. So that's the reason Prabhupada says in the purport that Lord Shiva, though Lord Shiva stays with, is associated with Maya. We will see in the further shloka that how he is associated with Maya. He is associated with Maya. Apparently he stays with Maya, but still he doesn't get swayed by Maya. So he neither falls in the Vishnu Tattva nor in the Jiva Tattva. So he is in between both. Further, Lord says that the material energy, the external energy which cooperates with me in my creation and manifests in the three mode of nature will no longer be able to bewilder you. That he is assuring Lord Shiva that you will never be bewildered by this energy. Now in 9.10, Maya Devshena Prakriti, this Prakriti is Durga Devi. Now the material energy in 9.10, Lord says to Arjuna, the material energy Prakriti works under my direction, O son of Kunti, and is producing all moving and unmoving beings. So this Prakriti whom Krishna is talking about is Durga Devi. Now Durga Devi is the wife of Lord Shiva, and thus Lord Shiva is in association with Maya. But Lord is assuring that still you will not get bewildered or you will not get captivated by this Maya anymore. And in Brahma Samhita also we see this shloka, Srishti Sthiti Pralaya Sadhana Shakti Eka Cha Eva Yasya Bhuvanani Pibarti Durga. So this Durga is who is working in cooperation with the Lord to create the cosmic manifestation. Now Lord has blessed Shiva that you have the all fortune and you will not be bewildered by this Maya anymore. Sukadev Goswami is saying that now Lord Shiva is going to return to his abode. So before going back, Lord Shiva knows the position of Lord Vishnu. He has glorified him so well in the initial few shlokas we saw. So now Lord Shiva is circumambulating him, the Lord who bears the mark of Srivatsa on his chest. And Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur remarks that when he is circumambulating, Lord Vishnu arises and embraces Lord Shiva, the mark of Srivatsa touches Lord Shiva's chest and he blesses Lord Shiva and he takes permission to go back to his abode Kailash. After this, Lord Shiva is addressing Bhavani, who is accepted as the potency, who is accepted by all the authorities as the potency of Lord Vishnu. He is telling that to Bhavani that you saw the illusionary energy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He is the unborn master of everyone. I am the principal expansion of him. Still I got bewildered what to say about others. He is saying to Bhavani that I was meditating for 1000 years. I was performing mystic yoga for 1000 years. At that time, you asked me on whom you are meditating. I'm meditating on this Supreme Lord, where time has no entrance and Vedas cannot enter. Time can enter anywhere and everywhere, but it cannot enter the kingdom of God. Vedas cannot, we cannot understand Lord along with Vedas. So Sukadev Goswami continues that, these are the last few shlokas. So Sukadev Goswami is now continuing that so this is the indication that the Lord is present everywhere. You know, he is omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent. Sukadev Goswami continues that I narrate you the transcendental pastime of the Lord who bore the great mountain on his back for the churning of the ocean of milk. He is the same personality who is known as Sarnanga Dhanva. Sarnanga is a bow which the Lord carries. Sukadev Goswami is further telling to Parikshit Maharaj that constantly hearing or describing the glories of the Supreme Personality of Godhead is the only way that we can come out of this material sufferings We can only, and it's only way to annihilate all the material sufferings that we endure in this material world. Satatam Kirtayantomam. I offer my respectful obeisances to such a person. The last shloka, he says that I am offering obeisances to such a great devotee who took a form of a beautiful woman and thus bewilders the demons and distributes his mercy to the devotees, the demigods, the nectar produced from the churning of the ocean of the milk. And the Lord who fulfills all the desires of his devotee, I offer my obeisances to him. Now, here we can see one point that we can understand that when the people may think that why he favored the demigods and why not the demons. So it is said in Bhagavad Gita 2.9.29 that I envy no one, nor am I partial to anyone. I am equal to all, but whoever renders service unto me in devotion is a friend in me, and I am also a friend to him. So it is like, you know, this is very natural that the children depends on the father's affection, and the father affectionately maintains the children. Similarly, the devotees who know only the lotus feet of the Lord, for such devotees, the Lord is always prepared to give protection to his devotees and fulfill their desire. So he tells Arjuna, O son of Kunti, declare it boldly that my devotees never shall perish. With this, I end the chapter on Mohini Moti bewildering Lord Shiva. These are some of the related shlokas that I've taken from Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam. I could only take some. Now, what are the takeaways? The main takeaway is that power of Lord's external energy can be overcome only by the grace of the Lord. Many times we feel that, yes, I can do it. I am strong. Maya cannot do anything to me. We take Maya very easy, you know. So we have to be very careful, but we don't know that when we get swept away by Maya, it is like every moment we are tested by Maya and we keep failing. The example of Ajamil itself says that he got so much attracted, even though he being a very learned person, he knew all the principles, still he got attracted. Even the example of Lord Shiva, Lord Vishnu is setting this example. This was the plan of Lord Krishna, to set an example to us that if I can enchant Lord Shiva with my internal potency, what to say about him? It is only by the mercy of Krishna, Guru and Prabhupada, it is possible to get out of it. Now, Shiva was able to get out of it. He regained his form only because he was a very pure devotee of the Lord. He was a pure devotee and he regained his form. But we are not able to do that because we can. It's not possible for us to get out of it so easily. And Sukadev Goswami says in the summary that we can get over this Maya by total surrender to Navavidha Bhakti. Shri Prahladuvacha Shravanam Kirtanam Vishnu Smaranam Padasevanam Archanam Vandanam Dasyam Sakhyam Atma Nivedanam. So no, and the other takeaways are that is only by doing the 9 devotional services we can get out of this Maya. Being in bhakti, chanting, rendering service to the lotus feet of the Lord, taking association of the devotees. We are very fortunate to be in this movement of Srila Prabhupada. Because of Srila Prabhupada's mercy, Krishna's mercy, Guru's mercy, we can fight this Maya. Then only we can become strong. So Prabhupada has also said that I have made some regulations, some rules and regulations to save you from this Maya. But if you cross that rules and regulations, then I will not be able to protect you. Then there is no mercy. And Prabhupada also says in one of the lectures that there is no midway. During the Bhakti Shastri course, somebody was asking a question to Maharaj recently what happened. Somebody asked a question. We were having a discussion about the food in the three modes of material nature. Somebody asked Maharaj that, can we have chocolate? So Maharaj said, chocolate cannot be had. It is against our rules and regulation because it has a component which we are not supposed to eat. So after some time when we were discussing this about different foods, then another Mataji asked that, can we have chocolate sometimes? And Maharaj strictly said no. So no is no. We, in bhakti, we cannot have a midway. When you take a midway, there are always a chance that we may fall down because we don't know what is moderation. Always good is being abstinent. Because moderation, we think that, okay, I'm doing only little, I'm eating only little, I'm watching TV only for little time. For 10 minutes, I'll watch TV. But when that 10 minutes becomes 1 hour, we don't know. So we have to be always, we have to be all be careful about Maya. When we get entangled in Maya, many kinds of degradation happens. Many times in our life, we see that we say that we will be able to handle this particular situation, or I am strong, I will do this. But Maya hits us in such a way that we are just thrown off like a small thing. Maya will just push us off like a small thing. If Mohini Murti is an example to teach us that if Lord Shiva can be enchanted, then what to say about us? We should always take the shelter of the lotus feet, then we become strong and we can fight the Maya. And we should keep on chanting and be grateful to be in the movement of Srila Prabhupada and take the Guru Ashray, because Guru is one person who will save us from this, who will connect us with Krishna and who will guide us that how to be in the service of Krishna and fight Maya. Now, this is an analogy regarding Maya. Maya is so thorough, just like water. If there is one little hole, the water will just find its way immediately to that hole. And the problem is our consciousness has so many holes. Our senses are so imperfect that we don't know from which side the Maya will affect us. I end my presentation by a quote from Srila Prabhupada. To the extent we are thinking of Krishna, to that extent, Maya has no influence, but as much as we are desiring to forget Krishna and trying to enjoy ourselves, so to that extent, we must suffer the pangs of Maya. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. Hope I was able to deliver to an extent. Hare Krishna to all.
Hare Krishna Mataji. Very, very nice presentation, Mataji. So, you have presented a delicate topic, a good amount of balance. So like Jagan Prabhu said, so whoever is taking Balaks of children's classes, so their way of taking these topics is which is different. So since we don't have time, so we will not be taking questions. I request devotees to send a comment. Either they can post it in the meeting chat or they can send it us in WhatsApp. So we'll relay to Mataji and then relay back the responses to them and in the group. So thank you once again, Mataji, for the nice presentation. So Jagan Prabhu, I would request for your feedback and comments. Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Mataji, thanks a lot. Thanks for very systematically and delivering. As Bandhu Baldev Prabhu said, it's a bit of a sensitive topic. A lot of questions keep rising when we read these kind of a pastimes. But we need to read them with all the sincerity. What I liked in you is that you were very not only dealt the sensitive and confidential topic in a very straightforward manner, convincing manner, and you did not omit anything here and there. So that's not easy. Thanks a lot for taking up this tough topic and delivering it well. A good batsman is a good batsman when he tries to bat in all types of pitches, and he faces all types of bowlers. So you have proved that you are a good batsman because you have taken the toughest bowler, very, very tough topic. So thanks a lot. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Prabhu, thank you for encouraging me. Thank you, Bandhubhai Prabhu. Thank you, Mataji. Thank you, Devdi Gopi Mataji.
Wonderful.
Hare Krishna Jagan Prabhu for the nice feedback. Mataji, since we are running out of time, we will not have the bhajan. So I request Kavita to apologize me. So to forgive me, sorry. And I request if Jagat Bandhu Achyuta Prabhu is ready, we can go.
Sorry Prabhu to overshoot the time because I tried my level best to consistency to 45 minutes, but I couldn't. Sorry Prabhu for that. Prabhu, give us 2 minutes because he is changing. He has changed his laptop.
Different ID.
I think it is going to be different.
Okay. He's ready, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna. So our next theme is going to be presented by His Grace Jagat Bandhu Achyuta Prabhu. So Jagat Bandhu Prabhu is a disciple of His Holiness Jayapataka Swami Maharaj, and Prabhu is known to take up seva, is always ready to do seva at very short notice. And Prabhu is a very silent and very calm devotee who is always kind of invisible. So I would like to take the liberty of sharing a friendly remark by Revati Gopi Mataji. So Mataji said that there are two devotees who, when they are in a congregation, they have to be searched and located because they are so silent. So one is Jagan Prabhu and another is Jagat Bandhu Achyuta Prabhu. So he is such a silent devotee. So he is going to take us through the pastimes of Lord Vamana Dev. So Hare Krishna Prabhu, I have made you as the presenter. Is it that BMDD/JBAD? Is it that ID? Ah, okay. So yes, Prabhu, over to you. Hare Krishna. Prabhu, please switch on your camera also, Prabhu. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. I hope you are audible to all of you. Hare Krishna.
Yes, Prabhu.
Yeah, Hare Krishna. By the mercy of Guru Maharaj and by the guidance and blessings of my Shisha Gurus and other Vaishnavas, I am going to make an attempt to discuss three chapters pertaining to Canto 8. This is my first attempt to discuss anything in Srimad Bhagavatam. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. The chapters which I am going to cover today are chapter number 17, the Supreme Lord agrees to become Aditi's son. Chapter number 18, Lord Vamanadev, the dark incarnation. And chapter number 19, Lord Vamanadev begs charity from Beli Maharaj. So my discussions are purely based on the translation and purport of our Acharya Srila Prabhupada, Jai Srila Prabhupada. So we are all very much aware of the discussions happened between Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, and is one of his friend and devotee Arjuna in the battlefield of Kurukshetra. Krishna has told to Arjuna, परित्राणाय साधुनां विनाशाय चतुष्कृतां धर्म संस्थापनाय संभवामि युगे युगे, to deliver the pious and to annihilate the miscreants as well as to re-establish the principle of religion, I myself appear millennium after millennium. So the chapters which we are going to cover today is going to, we are going to discuss about the one of the principal incarnation of the, his personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna. So in order to understand the flow of the in order to understand this particular incarnation or what necessitated this incarnation, we may have to touch upon some earlier chapters of this particular canto. So we will briefly go through those chapters. The chapter number 10, the battle between the demigods and the demons. Demigods and demons were constantly battling for supremacy, and they entered into ceasefire for churning of the ocean of milk to get the nectar. But unfortunately, demons, not being the devotee of Supreme Lord, could not get a benefit out of this particular activity. As we are all aware, Lord Vishnu has fed the nectar to the demigods. This has made the demons very angry. They get very agitated, and they declare a war against the demigods again. The demons were, Beli Maharaj become the leader of the demons. Indra, the king of heaven, along with other demigods, entered into a fierce battle with the demons. But with the grace of Supreme Personality of Godhead, demigod had upper hand. They start fighting with the demons with a renewed energy. Chapter number 11, King Indra annihilates the demons. Demigods started annihilating the demons. One by one, the demons were started killed actually. The leaders like Bali and his top commanders all fall down with the battlefield. There was a point of the battle, a point was reached at the battle. The demigods were about to annihilate the demons completely. But at that point, Lord Brahma has instructed Lord Narada Muni to go to the demigods and ask them to stop the killing. Based on the instruction of Lord Brahma, the demigods have stopped the war. Again, Narada has instructed whatever demons remained alive on the battlefield to take the bodies of Beli Maharaj and others to Astha Mountain. Shukracharya, by his mystic power, renewed the life of Beli Maharaj and those demons whose heads and bodies had not been completely lost. And chapter number 15, Beli Maharaj conquers the heavenly planet. By the grace of Shukracharya, Beli Maharaj has regained his life, and he has accepted Shukracharya as his spiritual master and started serving him. And Shukracharya is pleased by the service of his disciple and instructed to him to carry out Vishvajit Yajna. During this Yajna, from the fire of the Yajna, Beli Maharaj has received a series of benedictions like a chariot, horses, flag, armor, and quiver of arrows. And Maharaj Parishad, Maharaj Prahlad, the grandfather of Beli Maharaj, has given him an eternal garland of flowers, and Shukracharya has given him a conch shell. Beli Maharaj has paid his obeisances to Brahmanas, Prahlad Maharaj, and his spiritual master Shukracharya, and equipped him to fight with Indra and went to Indrapuri along with his soldiers. Blowing his counsel, he attacked the outskirts of Indra's kingdom. But by seeing Veli Maharaj's renowned power, Indra was very much worried. He has approached his spiritual master Brahaspati and discussed what should he do. Brahaspati has informed the demigods that Veli has been endowed with an extraordinary power by the Brahmanas, and it is extremely difficult to defeat him in a war. So he has suggested the demigods to leave the heavenly planet immediately and keep themselves somewhere invisible or go in hiding. Demigod had no option but to follow the orders of the spiritual master. So Veli Maharaj, along with his associate, gained entire kingdom of Indra. And Shukracharya, and he again engaged in the service of his Guru Maharaj. And Shukracharya, pleased with his Veli Maharaj services, and asked him to conduct 100 Ashwamedha Yagas. In this way, Veli enjoyed the opulence of heavenly planets. So next chapter we are briefly going to cover is chapter number 6, executing the Payobhata process of worship. Mother of demigods, Aditi, is extremely saddened by the plight of her sons. Because their sons are lost the kingdom, they are hiding in various places. And her husband, sage Kashyap Muni, has emerged from a trance of meditation and returned to the ashrama after many, many years. The moment he entered the ashram, he can immediately notice that things are not in place in ashram. Everybody is unhappy. The ashram is not well kept and everything. Then he approached Aditi and asked why you are so morose. Aditi has told him, I am lamenting from the absence of my sons. They lost their kingdom. So I am very sad about that particular thing. Then she requested him, please guide me. Please tell me, how can I help my sons so that they could return and reoccupy or regain their positions, actually. He advised her that only Lord Vasudeva or Lord Vishnu can help her to satisfy her and fulfill her desires. So then Aditi has expressed, if that is a condition, I wish to worship Lord Vasudeva. Then Kashyap Muni, who has learned from Lord Brahma how to satisfy Lord Krishna by the Payobhata process of worshipping, which executed in 12 days. So he advised his wife to observe this particular vow and his regulative principles. So now we're coming to chapter number 17. With this background, we will get into our point of discussion, actually. Aditi has performed the Payobhata ceremony for 12 continuous days. The Lord was pleased with her appeared before her. The moment Lord appeared before her, she was so perplexed, she was so taken aback, and she fell on the feet of Lord like a rod. She could not even talk to Lord for quite some time. And after regaining herself, she started paying her obeisances and prayers to the Lord. And Lord was pleased, and Lord has informed her, yes, I know why are you praying for me. I know your sons are in despair and they need to be brought back to their actual positions, the demons. But he also informed Aditi that as the demons are protected by Brahmanas, they are unconquerable now. And use of power against these demons as of now may not be a wise thing. But you are prayed for me. We are also well aware of the austerities followed by Kashyap Muni. I have only one option. I shall become your son and thus protect your other sons. So he asked her to go to her husband and worship him to get the son. So Aditi has become extremely happy to receive the very valuable benediction. With great devotion, he approached her husband. Kashyapamuni transferred his potency into the womb of Aditi. And Lord Brahma has understood Supreme Personality of Godhead now in the womb of Aditi, started offering his prayers. The Supreme Personality of Godhead appeared from the womb of Aditi. The Lord has appeared in forehand form, dressed in yellow garments with conch shell, club, lotus, and bees. This is just similar to the appearance of Lord Sri Krishna in the Karagraha of in front of Vasudeva. So Aditi and Kashyapamuni was extremely happy on the appearance of the god. The god has appeared on the day of Dwadashi and an auspicious moment of Abhijit, and the Dwadashi is called Vijaya. The entire universe becomes jubilant on the god's appearance actually. So the Lord appearance is described in Srimad Bhagavatam, the verse 8.18.12. The translation of this verse is, the Lord appeared in his original form with ornaments and weapons in his hand. Although this ever-existing form is not visible in the material world, he nonetheless appeared in this form. Thus, in the presence of his father and mother, he assumed the form of Vamana, a Brahmana dwarf, a Brahmachari, just like a theatrical actor. So immediately after the birth, the Lord has changed into Vamana Dev, matured and changed into Vamana Dev. So Kashyapamuni and all other great sages who present there immediately start up performing the ritualist ceremonies like birthday, sacred satrat ceremony, and everything. The Lord has been honored by various demigods. The sun god has personally uttered the Gayatri Mantra in his ears. Brihaspati has provided the sacred thread. Kashyapamuni has straw belt. Mother Earth has given the deer skin. Demigod Moon, Brahmadhand, Lord Brahma, water pot. Mother Saraswati, Rudraksha bead. Kubera, pot for begging. And Mother Parvati, the first almonds. After receiving all these benedictions, all these gifts, Sri Vamana Dev has set up a sacrificial fire and performing his fire sacrifices and performed his prayers. Immediately after completing this particular prayers, he proceeded to show his mercy to Bali Maharaj. So immediately, without even waiting for anything, the god has proceeded to meet Bali Maharaj. During this time, Bali Maharaj was performing the Ashwamedha sacrifices under the patronage of Brahmanas belonging to Bhrigu dynasty. The field near the northern bank of Narmada river. The Lord has appeared in the sacrificial arena of Maharaj Bali actually. The moment Lord appeared, owing to his transcendental effluent presence, priests, Bali Maharaj, all the members of assembly got attracted towards the Lord. They all stood from their seat and offered prayers to the Lord Vamana Dev. After washing Lord's feet, Bali Maharaj immediately accepted the water from the Lord's feet on his head actually. After the proper welcome, Bali Maharaj incurred Lord Vamana Dev welfare and requested the Lord to ask him for money, jewel, or anything he might desire. On hearing the pleasing offer from Beli Maharaj, Lord was satisfied and started praising Beli Maharaj. He told Beli Maharaj, you are basically respecting the Brahmanas and taking care of all their needs. So you are in a very exalted position owing to your service to the Brahmanas. And you have been instructed and guided by your grandfather, Prahlad Maharaj. So your life is in a very right direction. And your deeds and words are in complete agreement with the religious principle or Vedic principles. And no one in your family has refused to give a charity to a Brahmin. Nor after promising to give a charity, has anyone failed to fulfill his promise. This sentence is extremely important. After promising to give charity, has anyone failed to fulfill his promise? Then Lord Vamanadev asked Beli Maharaj what he wants. He said, I want 3 pieces of land to the measurement of my steps. Beli Maharaj was really surprised, and he has indicated to him, though you look like a learned Brahmin and you talk, behave like a learned Brahmin, but you're still a boy and your intelligence is not sufficient. I am giving an offer. I am the ruler of the entire universe. I am giving an offer to you, and you are asking only 3 pieces of land. So he said, you are not very prudent to regard your self-interest. I am a proprietor of 3 divisions of the universe. I can even give you an entire island to you. So you can ask as much as you want, as much land you want, according to your need. So please think about it and ask what exactly you want. But Lord Vamanadev replies, his replies are covered in some 4 to 5 verses of Srimad Bhagavatam. I have chosen 2 verses out of it. First verse is 8.19.21. The translation of this verse goes, the personality of Godhead said, O my dear king, even the entirety of whatever there may be within 3 worlds to satisfy one's senses cannot satisfy a person whose senses are uncontrolled. Here Lord Vamanadev is saying that persons whose senses are uncontrolled, he never can be satisfied. What all things available in the 3 worlds also was given to him, he cannot be satisfied. The next verse is 8.19.24. The translation goes, one should be satisfied with whatever he achieves by his previous destiny, for discontent can never bring happiness. A person who is not self-controlled will not be happy even with possessing the 3 worlds. Here again, the Lord saying that what all things people are getting in their life is purely based on their previous destiny, actually, previous Janma karma. So being discontent of what is you have in your hand will never bring happiness to you. So a self-controlled person can be happy what all things available with him. On the contrary, a non-self-controlled person will never be happy even after having everything in the 3 worlds. And then Lord Vamana has said to Beli Maharaj, I ask only 3 pieces of land. I want that only, nothing more than that. By such a gift, I will be very much pleased. I am fully satisfied to receive that which absolutely required by me. I don't need anything other than that. After hearing the words from Lord, Beli Maharaj just told him, All right, take whatever you like. So Beli Maharaj was he's convinced that this Brahmin boy is not going to ask anything further. Yes, okay, you take whatever you want to take. To confirm his promise to give desired land, he took up his water pot. So he was about to confirm that. What all things I have confirmed to you, it is will be given to you. At this point of time, Shukracharya, the spiritual master of Beli Maharaja's Indra, he immediately told. He understood this play of Lord Vishnu, and he told to Beli Maharaj, please note that this Brahmachari in the dark form is the Supreme Personality of Vishnu. So be very careful what you are going to promise to him. He has come here to fulfill the interest of demigods. He is the son of the mother of demigods, Aditi and Kashyapamuni. And he is a very dangerous, you will be in a very dangerous position by promising to give him land. And your promise may bring a lot of harm to the demons actually. So he indicated to him, say that he will take away everything from you and deliver it to the Lord Indra. And moreover, you never will fulfill his promise. By measure of one leg, he will cover the three universe, river, and the second leg, he will be cover the outer universe, and you may not have any place to offer the third leg. So what will we do? So don't do this particular thing. And he also, Shukracharya also told Beli Maharaj that you can say no to the request of Vamanadeva. There is nothing wrong in doing that particular thing. Because he gave the argument that charity which endangers one's own livelihood is not very wise actually. Saying no is wrong. But it protects you completely. It protects you completely, protect your family, protect their demons. So it is wise to say not to believe, not to Vamanadeva actually. I think with this, I think I'll be covering this particular topics. I know I am covered this pitch pretty fast actually. So one last thing I want to cover this is, this is a glory written by one of the greatest devotees of Supreme Personality of Jayadev in Gita Govind. Chalayasya Vikramane Belim Adbhuta Vamana Padanaka Neera Janita Janapavana Keshava Tirtha Vamana Rupa Jay Jagadishare. Okay, so in the form of Dwarf, you cleverly devised the king, deceive the king of the world, Beli, cleanser of the people through the seat of your toenails, praised to be Jagadish, Lord of the universe. So here, the Supreme Personality of Godhead has deceived the king Beli. So a lot of questions may come into your mind. Why? The Lord, Supreme Person of Lord God, why he deceived one of his devotees? We are all aware that Beli Maharaj is also a stringent devotee of Supreme Lord, like his grandfather. So why should Lord deceive him and take everything away from him? I think a lot of these questions could able to be answered by Sant Govishwar Prabhu in his tomorrow's presentation. He will be covering the balance topic of this particular incarnation of the God. Hare Krishna Prabhu, I am over with it. Thank you. Any questions I may try to answer?
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Hare.
Yes, Prabhu. Yes, Prabhu.
Prabhu, you are in mute.
Well, Prabhu, you go.
Bandhubaldev Prabhu, you go ahead. After that, I'll ask a question.
Hare Krishna. So, thank you so much, Jagat Bandhu Prabhu. You have done very well. You have done ahead of time, far ahead of time. Hare Krishna. So, there is one question from Madhu Prabhu. So, it is there in the meeting chat. The question is that Bali Maharaja had such good qualities, much better than many demigods, always enjoying their opulences. Hence, Lord Vamanadev could have allowed Maharaja to rule. Instead, he was eliminated. So, a little bit difficult how to understand this.
He didn't eliminate, no?
Instead, eliminate. Room akkada chu kindi ga khata
door keeper kinda pettadu
ah tarvata and kindi mampisthadu and position nunchi
he gives him eternal service, right?
Hare Krishna Prabhu, a lot of this your doubts will be Madhu Prabhu, a lot of this your doubts will be cleared by the other part of the presentation, was where the incarnation balance part of the incarnation will be covered tomorrow. But the basic thing is that yes, the demigods were the actual supposed to be ruled the heavens. So the Lord want to re-establish that order. So that is the reason it was being decided, or it was even Lord himself has indicated to Aditi that it is going to be very difficult to remove Bali Maharaj. So it cannot, not a war cannot be turned. So that is one of the reason why he used, deceived him to do that particular. It means that it is also difficult for the Lord to do that. I requested the Jajivan Prabhu also to clarify more on that.
Yeah, Hare Krishna. Thanks a lot, Prabhu, for simple and a very good presentation. I don't know if it's a coincidence or Bandhubaldev's choice that he has given you a very appropriate topic, because it's very much connected with Kerala. So kindly enlighten us in how way Bali Maharaj pastime is connected with Keralites and the Onam festival.
This belief is that Bali Maharaj was ruling Kerala beautifully. Everything was proper. There was even the song also, it is indicated there is no cheating, no theft. Everybody was happy. Everything was beautiful at that point of time. Then Bali Maharaj came, Vamanadev came and put him to the Padal. At the time of him going to the Padal, Lord has given one of the boon to him. Once in a year, you can come back and see your people. So that particular day is Onam. So every that day, Keralites, there's a 10-day festival actually. It is starting from first day and to the 10th day is the Onam day. So Keralites welcome Bali Maharaj to his yearly visit of his Praja. So we celebrate, cut across all religious lines, we celebrate this festival every year.
Oh, okay.
Hare Krishna Prabhu, even Mohini Murthy and this Lord Shiva's incarnation also is related to Kerala, because Lord Ayyappa happened through that combination of Mohini Murthy and Lord Shiva.
Oh, okay.
So it's a coincidence that Bandhubaldu Prabhu gave us both of us something related to Kerala.
Very good. Thank you, Mata. Thanks a lot, Prabhu. As your nature, because your nature is very much reflected in your presentation, you did it in a very simple form, but it was very attractive because the way you put these slides, very simple slides. And as the Leela was going on, it's very easy to absorb that Leela and also enjoy, because
sometimes when people with a lot of enthusiasm, and when they tell the leela, they go crisscross lot of shlokas, Bhagatam, Bhagavad Gita, and it'd be overwhelming sometimes to understand. But your class remained to point and very focused and very simple, and you picked up very nice shlokas also. In that way, it was very good. I was really enjoying as you were slowly, slowly, nicely reading those very point, and it's like a slow motion of the whole Bali Maharaj Vamandev pastime in a concise manner. So that's pretty interesting. So everyone has got their own wonderful ways of teaching and preaching. Your thing I was really was attractive, and you remind me of a very couple, a family which was there, Laila Mataji, Gopal Panikar Prabhu. They were also from Kerala, and they were one of the founding members, among the founding members of this congregation. So Mataji was a good reader, and she was a good preacher, and she was pretty talkative, and she was one of the favorite students of Mani Prabhu. She used to attend all his classes, and I can compare Mataji, Laila Mataji, what's her initiated name?
Leela
Dakshi Devidasi Mataji, to your wife. Good in attending classes, writing, want to talk, and very bubbly in nature. And Panikar Prabhu was exactly opposite. He was probably the most sattvic ever personality that Damodaresh has ever seen. Very sattvic, very soft spoken, and very service oriented. He used to drop his wife regularly, said take his kids Divya and Dhanush. And he was very well liked by Mani Prabhu a lot. So actually, in the whole of Srimad Bhagavatam, Mani Prabhu has dedicated a shloka to Panikar Prabhu, the last shloka of Srimad Bhagavatam. So whenever the last shloka of Srimad Bhagavatam is read, any place, any event, he always used to ask Panikar Prabhu to recite the shloka. And that family has done a phenomenal service. In those days, Damodar Desh was a small congregation, and they had a big house. All our program, Janmashtami, Radhashtami, Jayapataka Maharaj visit, everything used to happen in their house only. So first, a lot of first generation kids know them very well, and now they are back settled in Kerala. Unfortunately, a few years back, we lost Panikar Prabhu due to some illness, but Mataji still serves in does some service in the Trivandrum temple. So you, your family reminds me of their thing, and particularly you remind of me of him, because he exactly like you, very sattvic, a very practical and down to earth devotee. So continue to be like this, Prabhu, and then inspire a lot of people with your silence and with your service, and at the same time, whenever an opportunity comes, very beautifully trying to tell people what it needs to be told. Thanks a lot. Hare Krishna. Dhanda Pranam.
Hare Krishna. Thank you, Jagan Prabhu, for the nice words, and thank you, Jagat Bandhu Achyuta Prabhu, once again. We have maybe 5 minutes for questions, and since Bindu Madhavi Mataji is also there, if there are any questions from this presentation, this theme, or from the first theme, so we have 5 more minutes. Hare Krishna.
Yeah, I only wanted to make one comment, Prabhu. When like the topic that Bindu Madhavi Mataji has told, we tend to look at only from a point of view of, you know, Shiva and his attraction towards Mohini, now grave Shiva. There's a very natural tendency to cover the topic with the flow of the way the it is narrated. But there is a other bigger dimension to that, is that if one reads that pastime slightly more deeply, slightly introspect, the whole topic can also be covered as a leela. What is the leela dimension of that topic, rather than Shiva oriented description? That I again say, the narration goes, take us through like that, but there's a bigger element of a purpose of why Lord would have done that from a leela perspective, That I would request Bindu Madhav Mataji to read further and probably listen to some lectures here and there. And then probably next opportunity time she can dwell in that. And then when we approach the topic from a Leela perspective, that a Leela is being performed by Lord with a very, 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 very predetermined objective. So he has to basically give some roles to these people, and they're enacting those roles. And so when they're enacting roles, there's no need for us to associate them with the role itself. So there's another dimension to that. It's like somebody's playing a villain, somebody's playing like a hero, somebody's having like that, right? So they play so well, and we appreciate that. But that doesn't mean they become that. So there's a very another dimension to that, considering the position of Shiva. That angle also can be seen. And these kind of revelations, sometimes we may not get in the purport, because purport has a dimension of a narration. These kind of things can be picked up from very senior Vaishnava lectures. Probably if she can pick up somewhere on the web, one definitely Radha Govind Maharaj, the way he would have narrated this, or Navayogendra Swami Maharaj, the way he would have narrated this, probably would be a bit a different flavor to that. Don't get me wrong, there is always a different dimensions of anything, right? But clearly when these complicated topic comes, the Leela domination should be more than the personalities or the actors in the play. So when we keep remembering that, then our thing is, perspective might change. This is only a suggestion. When I'm telling to her, I'm also telling to myself. It's difficult. It needs a lot of work to do that. But once you do that, it's a very different thing. So Hare Krishna. Thanks a lot.
Hare Krishna, Jagan Prabhu. Thank you once again. Hare Krishna, Bindu Madhavi Mataji, Jagat Bandhu Achyuta Prabhu. Thank you once again for the nice presentation. So we will move on to the quiz. So over to you, Santa.